Hello and welcome to Arguing Toss from GameIndustry.com. I'm Shella.
And I'm Drew, and together we're arguing about the things that really matter in games.
Yes, today we have a special guest with us, our first ever guest on Argue the Toss,
yep.
And that is Dr. Wendy Powell. So I'll give you a little short intro on Wendy, who has done a lot of amazing, sort of exciting-sounding things. She is a reader in virtual reality in the School of Creative Technologies at Portsmouth University. She's also an active researcher in VR and interactive technologies for health, well-being, and education, and also studies the impact of hardware and software on user behavior and perception. And Wendy is also a senior member of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, or otherwise known as the IEEE, which describes itself as the world's largest technical professional organization dedicated to advancing technology for the benefit of humanity, no less. Welcome to Argue the Toss, Wendy.
Thanks, it's great to be here.
So that's quite an exciting aim for the IEEE, advancing technology for the benefit of humanity. What sort of thing does that involve?
It's really, it sounds very pretentious, doesn't it? But it's really very, very broad. At its widest, it really means that anything we can do to use technology to make things better in our lives, sort of personally and socially. So for my particular area, that's applying it very much into the sort of taking games technology and putting it into kind of health and well-being and kind of those sort of socially improving areas, you might say. But really anything where we can use technology to improve our lives. So everything from improving the efficiency of cars or reducing emissions or using technology to improve our leisure in a good way, or really anything where we can apply sort of the engineering technology into improving our lives or our environment. So, as broad as you like, really.
Yeah.
So, well, I'm sure our listeners would agree that games benefit humanity. It enables adults to continue to play past childhood. And AR has, your augmented reality has hit the headlines recently with Pokémon Go having people wandering through parks trying to catch mini monsters. So I was wondering, do you see AR as a gateway to VR, or are they two completely different experiences that will follow different development paths?
Well, I think they are very different, and I think you are right about, games are good for us. Playing is something we should never grow out of. And AR obviously is hugely in the headlines at the moment, with particularly with Pokémon Go and people getting out and about and playing outside instead of on their sofa,
yeah.
Which is great. But AR and VR, there's what's called a continuum, in fact Milgram's continuum, which puts VR, kind of virtual reality, those immersive, shutting away the real world experiences on one end of the continuum, and then the real world is right at the other end. And augmented reality is somewhere closer to the real world. Augmented reality, you kind of create digital content that overlays our view of the real world, so you're very much in the real world, whereas virtual reality, the whole point is to shut out the real world and to be somewhere different. So I think they're very different, and the technology behind them is quite different, but there is a huge overlap, and this whole area of what we call mixed reality kind of moves from one end of the spectrum to another. So it's really interesting time seeing where the technology is going.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you see as the key challenges for VR and AR? What different challenges do they have?
Well, they've got some challenges that are similar and some that are different. I think the VR challenges, a lot of it focuses at the moment around the tracking, the ability to know where we are in the physical space and what our bodies are doing in relation to that physical space and how that influences the virtual world. So some of the headsets, even the cheapest ones like Google Cardboard, have got basic head tracking. You turn your head around and it changes your view in the virtual world, which in itself is really immersive. But we're in the physical world and we want to be able to reach out and touch, and we don't want to fall downstairs or bump into walls when we're moving in VR. And I think that ability to really physically interact in the VR and in our physical space safely is really missing from VR at the moment. You've got things like the HTC Vive, which are trying to solve that, and they've moved a long way towards it, but you still need a good space that's kind of predetermined in order to make it safe and to be able to touch that physical space. And it's still a big disconnect between the virtual and the real. And I think, certainly for me, that's one of the big challenges for VR, is can we really know where we are in that physical space in a very dynamic, real-time way? We're doing some work at the moment at the University of Portsmouth on what's called substitutional reality, where we're trying to real-time reconstruct the physical space around us and then substitute objects in the real world with virtual ones. So, for example, the desk in front of you might become the console of a spaceship, that kind of thing. The cup on your desk is a goblet. But there's a long way to go before we can get that, you know, really seamless. So that's with the VR end. Augmented reality is very different, because we're kind of overlaying digital objects on the real world. So, no, again, knowing where we are in that space is important, being able to put the digital objects kind of in the right place. So like Pokémon Go, you don't really want your Pokémon sort of floating up in the sky. You might want them actually sitting on top of a column or hiding in a doorway. So knowing precisely where you are. And at the moment, the GPS tracking, the onboard phone tracking, they really suffer a lot with noise and interference. And you can write algorithms that smooth that out a bit. But the ability to know very precisely where we are in that physical space and overlay the augmented content onto the physical space, it's not really there yet. And I think probably the other big thing, or maybe the difference between them, is that VR, we've really made huge leaps forwards with the graphics quality, the screens, the displays for VR. But AR, it's still not quite there yet, certainly not on consumer release. It's a very different type of display, because with VR, we just have to display digital content. But with augmented reality, you've got to show that real world on the screen as well as the virtual. And that's a very different way of displaying information. And at the moment, we haven't really got anything that does that really well. So you tend to use kind of a mobile phone or a tablet. You know, we're all holding our breath, hoping that the HoloLens type tech is going to do it. But we're not we're not quite there with the screens yet, so there's still some more development to go, I think.
I think I am more excited about AR than VR, just because it'll be fantastic, I don't know, to have Mario running across my desk or something, or, you know, just it would be so fantastical.
I think there's
just to have stuff growing out of my floor.
There is, I think there's a wow factor with AR that you don't really get. It's different from the VR one, and the fact that you're still in the real world. I mean, VR, you've got to shut yourself out of the real world, and it's very limiting. But AR, you can literally be walking around, and people are, Pokemon Go, people are wandering around chasing the Pokemon, and they're in the real world. They're not shut away in their bedrooms. And I think that's really exciting. But they're different. Yeah. They're two completely different experiences.
And yeah, that sort of leads into my next question, which is that you were saying AR is not here, but low cost sort of consumer level VR is, like, it's already here. I mean, you were talking about Google Cardboard, and I've got a Gear VR, Samsung Gear VR here, which was not prohibitively expensive. So what do you think is the immediate future of this technology? Is everyone going to have one in the next 5 years, or what are we going to see from VR in the near future?
I think in terms of everybody having it, I mean, there's this huge upsurge in interest at the moment. And it's not just the early adopters of technology and the gamers. You know, it's really catching the imagination of the kind of the non-traditional, non-techie people. So I think we're still going to be seeing a bit more of an upsurge. I mean, there are sort of 5 million plus just Google Cardboard owners, never mind all the other headsets. I don't think it's going to just keep on going up and up and up. I think there's going to kind of hit a peak and then come down a bit when the hype sort of dies down a little. I think at the moment we still need, especially with the kind of the lower cost VR, we need better resolution. We need a better field of view. We need better tracking. You've either got the tethered devices like the Oculus Rift and the Vive, which are still very much tied to a high-end computer and external tracking, or you go for portable, but the resolution isn't so good. And if you spend more than about 15 minutes in it, unless it's a really good app, you're going to feel quite uncomfortable. I think for it to really have staying power, we need that physical interaction between us and the environment. If VR is really, really going to work, we've got to find some way of untethering us from our computers or our seats and being able to kind of really move around in that space. That, for me, and particularly in the work we do with physical rehab, where you want people moving in that space and interacting. But But sense of touch and the sense of smell as well, there are things missing from our senses. There's a big wow with the visual immersion and, you know, good audio, well-designed virtual reality audio is fantastic. But you still can't really reach out and touch that virtual world, and you can't smell it and taste it. And there are hints of that technology coming. I've seen some really interesting prototypes of VR experiences where you can feel the sun on your face and smell the scents of the food, and that then is really exciting.
Yeah. So, I mean, even if we do solve these problems, do you think there are enough useful or perhaps medical applications for VR that most people are going to, you know, have some sort of VR equipment in their homes, or do you think it would be most standard equipment for like specific purposes? Like, I know you've researched sort of VR in anxiety and depression treatment, things like that. Do you think it would be a widespread thing or a more specific thing?
I think, like medical apps for smartphones, they're taking off hugely, and a lot of people have got fitness apps, health apps, even sort of information apps about their condition, apps to monitor specific conditions, and that's getting really widespread. And I think VR and AR have got the potential to do something similar. Certainly there's some fantastic work going on in VR and health at the moment, not just the work with the mental health conditions, but physical rehab, and we're working at the moment on managing pain in amputees. And those sort of applications have got massive potential to change the way we treat people. I think, will everybody have a health app in VR? Probably not, because I don't think VR is going to be suitable for everything that we need treatment for. And I think it will be very much geared around specific conditions. But I think it will be pretty widespread. There's a lot, well, we're still discovering what VR has got the potential to do and some of the effects it can have on managing pain, managing anxiety, help people to understand conditions, improving movement. Lots we don't really know yet. Lots of good research going on. So it'll be really widespread. Everybody having it? No, I don't think so. But I think there'll be a lot of treatment applications in the home that are VR or AR based.
So what existing like treatment problems does VR solve when it comes to treating mental health issues and or just generalized health issues? What can we do with it that we couldn't do before?
Well, there are kind of a whole load of different areas. One of the big ones that's grown really fast and really well is the kind of the anxiety and phobia type areas. And I think they've probably grown fastest because you can sit down to experience those. You don't need to be physically moving around, so the tracking problem isn't so big. So you've got things like the Virtual Reality Medical Center over in America, who treat a lot of phobias. They've been doing that for quite a number of years now. They treat sort of fear of flying, fear of heights, fear of spiders with exposure therapy, that you can have this sort of very safe, controlled, gradual exposure to a fear stimulus that you can't really do in the real world. You know, like take spider phobia. You can't predict what a spider's going to do. I mean, you can take somebody in somewhere where you've got a tank of spiders, but you can't expose them in the same way you can in VR. And you can't kind of switch it on and off and reduce it or increase it in response to how that person's reacting. So yeah. I think things like that, you know, have got massive potential, and they're already doing the world of good. And then you've got things like Brave Mind, which is used for treating post-traumatic stress disorder. It's used already in about sort of 60 military rehab centres, where they're kind of recreating some of the stimuli that the military vets with post-traumatic stress are suffering with, and gradually exposing them in a very safe way and reducing that post-traumatic stress and getting them back fit to work again, which, you know, that's an incredibly hard area to treat, and it's been quite successful. So I think we don't know enough yet. And then there's the pain management. I mean, it's been used for quite a long time for managing things like acute pain, changing burn dressings and things. But some of the areas...
How does it do that?
Partly there's the distraction element. There's some really great work done by somebody called Hunter Hoffman, who did a lot of the early work, working with pediatric burn victims. And he created a game called Snow World, where the children were playing in this very cold, snowy environment, throwing snowballs deliberately to kind of take them away from the memories of the heat and the burn, and reducing their morphine massively while they were having their dressings changed. To begin with, it was just distraction, but then they did brain studies that showed that the pain areas of the brain were being suppressed directly by the VR. So it's not fully understood yet how it works, but it does. And then we're doing work with phantom pain with amputees when they have an arm removed, 90% of the time, they still have an awareness that the arm is there, and it's often very, very painful. And you know that kind of visualizing the missing arm really helps manage the pain, but it's really hard to do. So we're creating apps in VR that allow them to visualize the missing arm using signals from the muscles. So they can see the arm as if it was still there. So there's all sorts of different ways that VR can really help, you know, limited by our imagination, really. We're still just beginning to discover what's possible. And and you can gamify it, which makes it so much more
fun. Yeah.
I mean, most people have done really boring exercises in the gym where you kind of have to do 50 leg lifts or something in order to rehabilitate your injured knee. But when that's a game and they've got kids kicking ninjas around to do the exercises, so much more fun.
Yeah, that's amazing.
You've
also commented that medical use of VR could be a sort of double-edged sword in that unskilled, unmonitored use of treatment apps could, especially in the case of mental health, could compound rather than treat problems, and that it might be something that needs regulation and prescription. Now, I wonder if that's feasible at all, given that homebrew VR apps are already becoming prevalent. Do you think this is going to be a potentially significant problem? What steps can we take to mitigate this, do you think?
I think the answer is yes and no. I mean, with everything, since the beginning of medicine, there's always been people jumping on the bandwagon and kind of selling snake oils, things that maybe might do more harm than good, or at best do no good. And I don't think VR is any different from anything else in that regard, in that, yes, of course, there are going to be lots of homebrew apps, some of which might be really good and some of which might really do some harm. It is a problem. But I think we'll probably address it the same way we do with all the other medicines and sort of health treatments that are offered that we don't know whether they're any good or not. I think partly it'll be common sense. You know, where does it come from? What do we know about it? There has been a lot of talk by people like the British Standards Institute about regulating health applications. And I don't think it's going to be realistic to kind of make it illegal to make a health app. But I think if there was some sort of standardization, you could maybe achieve a certain standard, a bit like the kind of kite marking standards and things where, you know, this app has been approved, then if people could know that it was an approved app or that it was prescribed by somebody, a trusted physician or a healthcare professional who said, yeah, this is one we know is being researched and evidenced and therefore is safe to use. And I think if we apply the same sort of common sense we do to any medical treatments, really, it would be fine. And we work really closely with the medical professionals to make sure that what we're creating is going to be both effective and safe, and we'd really like to see standards applied so, you know, you could get some sort of accreditation. So I think it'll probably go that way. But yeah, I think anything, even, you know, there's been so much talk anyway about how games can affect our mental health, and I don't think that's going to be any different with VR. Those debates are still going to be had, and it's just we've just got to proceed sensibly, both individually and socially, to make sure that we are making ourselves as safe as possible, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, that actually leads quite neatly onto one of the key questions I have, which, you know, you were just talking about how VR can help people cope with mental health issues or even reduce the feeling of burns for children. I mean, that's incredible. But, you know, games have this ongoing relationship with violence and killing as a gameplay mechanic, whether it's for a high score or just for kicks. So what are your concerns regarding some sort of psychological fallout from playing in, for instance, a very real-seeming war setting or a horror game?
That's a good contentious topic. Yeah. there are really good arguments for either side, I think. There are people who'd say that, you know, it'll definitely make people more violent. You, for instance, you've got the military use something called stress inoculation training, where they use violent games or, you know, and violent VR in order to reduce the impact of the stress that's going to have on the soldiers when they go out to a war zone. Yeah. Now, I don't think and there's certainly nothing to suggest that that's actually used to make them more violent. I think it's more about reducing the stress and the negative reactions they get when they're exposed to that. But it does raise some interesting questions around how we are influenced by our exposure to VR. There've been some early studies that suggest that maybe being exposed to violence in video games sort of suppresses the inhibition of some of our impulses. But I don't think there's any really good evidence that a non-violent person will become violent by exposing themselves to violent games. And to be honest, since the Victorian times and before, we've been having these debates, you know, the penny dreadfuls were going to ruin people's morals, Tom and Jerry cartoons were horribly violent and were going to make our children attack each other. And the reality is that kind of the population that are most likely to play these violent video games, there has been no increase in violent crime in that demographic during the last kind of couple of decades, which I think is quite interesting. And even there are studies that kind of correlate the two and say, well, violent people seem to play more violent video games, but is that because they're more drawn to them in the first place? So I think we don't know enough, and I think we have to be careful. And the very fact that we're using VR to have long-term psychological benefits does it has long-term psychological effects. So I think we keep an eye on it, and I think we need to not be naive and pretend that there's no influence. But I also think there's a lot of scaremongering, and I don't think, you know, if your 12-year-old plays Grand Theft Auto in VR, that he's going to suddenly go out and run over grannies on pedestrian crossings. I think that's probably a little unrealistic.
I certainly haven't yet.
No, I was just about to say exactly that. I haven't run anyone. I can't even drive. So.
But we don't know, and I think we always have to be a little bit careful about what we know, and we shouldn't be too blasé. We know that it has effects. We know that it has long-term effects. We're focused at Portsmouth very much on leveraging those long-term effects for good. But you have to be aware that that means there could be, as with everything, there could be potential for harm too. And we just need kind of socially aware and individually aware, I think.
I mean, I wasn't thinking about sort of the violence of it making people violent. I was thinking about, you know, some sort of, is there a risk of some sort of trauma from, you know, playing a horror game that feels real? I mean, I wouldn't go anywhere near it. So, you know, is there a risk of, you know, really terrifying someone or...
You know, it is something that's a really interesting question. I mean, I couldn't even cope with The Room, which is Google Cardboard's. It's just an empty room VR experience. And 5 minutes in, you know, all I need to see was kind of an empty chair, and I was terrified and wanted to take it off. So I'm not very good with horror anyway. I guess. I think we have to be careful. I mean, we've been working recently on doing a kind of a VR application and game for people with a fear of heights, and we're very, very aware that we need to expose people to that fear stimulus very carefully, because they do have a very measurable response in their behaviour, in their emotions, and even in their heart rate. And I do think we have to be careful of that. Is there a lasting trauma? I'd love to say no, but the reality is I don't think there's been really enough research yet to say either way. And I guess it's ethically a bit sort of shaky ground doing research on exposing people to really horrific horror and then seeing if it's traumatized. But I do think we have to be careful. And I think, again, some of that's self-regulatory. I won't put myself into horror VR because I know it's going to I'll have nightmares. I have nightmares watching horror films. And I think it will be no different. But it is... when you're surrounded by it, when you're in it, and you know something comes out of the walls, or you know you're suddenly being attacked by a monster with an axe, when you're in VR, that's a very, very different experience than if you're watching it on a screen. And I think it's a big unknown, and I suspect the answer is yes, there could be psychological trauma, but I certainly wouldn't want to be officially quoted on that, because I haven't done the research, and from what I've seen so far, nobody's done solid research on that yet, and I think we need to wait and see. But I think we need to be careful.
I mean, you know, sort of, where do you think the responsibility lies with the creators, you know, in terms of that, you know, what people create for VR in terms, you know, I'm thinking in terms of games, obviously.
I think As with every kind of creative endeavor, especially one that makes money, people are going to push the boundaries wherever the money is going to go, and people are going to buy more. We're constantly seeking the next thrill, the next edge of the experience, the next boundary, and I don't think that's going to change. There's going to be a lot of crying out about restricting artistic and creative freedom if we start to legislate around that. But there is also the argument of social and moral responsibility. You know, is that on the creators, or is that on individuals as to what they buy and play, or is that on society to regulate and kind of put limits or legal boundaries around what can be created? And I think VR has sort of exploded so quickly. It's been around for a very long time, but this kind of last few years has been this huge explosion. And I just don't think the legislation and the sort of safety regulations have caught up yet, because we just don't know. So I think it's a bit of a mixture. I think there is a responsibility about what content creators create, but I think there's also that kind of individual and social responsibility of us being aware of the potential for harm and just using common sense. You know, same as with anything else, with smoking, with drinking, with all the other things that harm us, there is a certain individual responsibility to make sure that we use it in a sensible way, I guess.
Yeah. So do you think we will see, like smoking and drinking, do you think we'll see cases of VR addiction or certain app addiction?
I think to a certain extent you see that with technology already. There's technology itself, games, social media. It hits the pleasure centres in your brain, and there are people who become addicted. It's really hard. I mean, think how hard it is not to check your Facebook or, you know, I'm just going to play one more level of that game.
Hours of Dark Souls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's that fine line. Is it addiction, or is it just I really, really like doing it and a bit obsessive? When it becomes an addiction, that where you've got that sort of almost chemical response, which you do get to things that give you pleasure, even running people can become addicted to. I think there will be huge overuse, but to be honest, my feeling is VR will probably self-regulate to a certain extent on that. Long-term exposure to VR is actually pretty uncomfortable for most people. You can do it for a while, but you end up kind of feeling a bit nauseated. You can get double vision, bit of dizziness. You just generally don't feel great if you're in VR. There is one brave researcher who's immersed himself for a full 24 hours in VR.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
But
it wasn't pretty.
No, and I think that to a certain extent will limit what we do with VR more perhaps than video games. I don't think we'll play VR for as long as people immerse themselves in video games without stopping. So I don't think it's going to make the problem worse. But I could be wrong.
How do you think VR and maybe AR as well will change the way we socialise? You know, do you see any benefits or any drawbacks, you know, because obviously VR you're kind of immersed. Do you think we'll be socializing in the virtual? And
I think social VR is one of the really interesting potential future directions, because phone is okay, Skype is nice because you can see each other, but getting into VR and either meeting in that virtual space or even just, you know, we've knocked up a couple of apps and so have other people, effectively putting your Skype screen into VR, that makes it so much more real. You're so much more connected with the person, but also being able to appear as an avatar or a character and interacting with people in VR, I think has got some really interesting potential. You know, can we do eye tracking and get proper eye contact in VR between our characters? So I think there's a lot in VR that gives us the potential to socially connect in a very different way and possibly in a very positive way. But there's also that, you know, we shut ourselves out from the real world. You've got your headphones on and your VR headset on, and it's a very individual experience being in VR in many ways. When you watch somebody in VR, unless you've got a mirror screen, it's really weird. You know, they're moving around, reacting and doing weird stuff, and you've got no idea what's going on. And you can't even share it the same way you share a video game. So I think there's an argument both ways. AR, very different, because you don't shut yourself away from the real world. And, you know, coming back to it again, Pokémon Go is a great example. I don't yet know whether the hype is going to kind of last. There are as many negatives as positives, but it is getting people out and about and into the same social spaces. So I think that ability of augmented reality to move people into those social spaces, it's similar, in fact, made by the same company, Ingress, which was kind of an earlier version, not AR in quite the same way. But it does bring people out. They meet up in pubs, they have teams, they fight. they party, and it's created a whole sort of social environment around the augmented game. And I think things like Pokémon Go are going to do the same. They'll create this whole community, a real physical community, and that could really improve socialising. So I think if you're naturally a very isolated person, I don't think it's going to suddenly fix that. But it maybe gives potential solutions, like people with sort of social phobias, the ability to connect virtually or even via an avatar in a way that they probably wouldn't in the real world, is maybe a very positive thing. So I guess it's a bit of a wait and see, but it's certainly got the potential to change how we socialise.
I'm interested to see what apps come out that sort of try to do that in a new way, to sort of like having, you know, for example, Second Life in VR or other, you know, just purely social apps where the point of it is to walk around a shared space and interact with people. I'm really interested to see what kind of things developers come up with that take advantage of VR.
Yeah, I think I am too. I mean, I think that, you know, Second Life was, you know, so hugely popular, and really it is just a social platform. And I think VR has got the potential to do something similar, but on a much grander and more immersive scale. But then, of course, it's got far more challenges in this terms of the content development. Sort of 3D content development is very different, and moving around in VR is very different. And there's a lot about developing for VR. It's not just about putting a 3D headset onto a 2D game or 2D experience. It's a very different way of developing. So I think we've got a while before that's a really good immersive experience that we can do socially. But I am quite excited to see what happens with it. I think there's some really interesting stuff going to happen, especially with Facebook having got so involved in VR and some of the other really big companies. It's I think there are plans afoot.
Are there any killer apps on the way that you know of and can tell us about that you think will really sell VR devices? Or
I would love
even
to say,
AR?
Yes, I would love to say that, I've had a sneak preview of the one I really think is a killer VR AR app.
Right.
The reality is, no, I don't think so yet. I think there's, we're riding on the wave of the enthusiasm, the excitement at the moment, and things are being developed fast. And there are some companies that are really kind of investing time in doing what I'd call proper VR development. So the experiences are more than just a 2-minute wow factor. But at the moment, it's mostly about taking the experiences we already know from things like video gaming and entertainment and film and putting them into VR. And I think our app is going to be when we do something different. I don't think we've got that yet. I don't know what it's going to be. It's a brilliant time to be working in the field. I love that this is my field right now. But I don't know what that killer app is yet. And I don't think it's there. It might be hidden in somebody's secret R&D room. But I've seen a hint of a real killer app yet.
Okay, well, when you find it,
I'll let you know.
And we'll have to bring you back on.
I think that's part of the sort of whole appeal of VR for me, is that even though I don't quite know what it's going to be, I just sense that there's something exciting we're going to be able to do with this technology, something revolutionary, something world-changing, and I can't wait to find out what that is, what the interesting application, the brand new thing that we invent for this is going to be.
I agree. I mean, the IEEE VR research community is doing some amazing work in VR, and they're often kind of pushing the boundaries and doing things very, very different. And that when that sort of fundamental research jumps out into the development community, we could see some interesting things happening. But I mean, I've been researching at Portsmouth in VR. We had one of the very first sort of big VR setups in UK universities, and I've been in there for about 10 years, and it was big, expensive, very, very, very specialised area, even a decade ago, and it's just changed massively. And I have to say, being a researcher in VR is just the most awesome thing to be working in at the moment, because you know you do get to play with those blue skies ideas. What would be really fun? What would be really cool? What would be really clever? What would be really effective in VR? That's just something completely different. So, it's a really exciting time. I agree, Drew. We get that sense that there's the big thing's almost there.
It's just around the corner. You know, we had 3D, you know, in the movie industry, which hasn't really taken off as they expected. But I just feel that VR and AR are going to, you know, go the full way. 3D never did. You know, consumers didn't really want it as much as the movie industry thought we did.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing. It's there's a difference between sort of technology being pushed on to consumers when they don't really want it, and this is very consumer led. There's a huge demand, and the consumers are saying what they want and how they need the technology to improve. And there's been a lot of, especially with the VR and the games tech, there's been a lot of pushing things out very early, getting the developer community involved, the wider community, and getting that feedback early on, so that it's kind of driven as much by the consumers and developers as it is by the kind of the big companies. And I think that's probably the difference, is we're going to get what we want, not what somebody else thinks we want.
Exactly. Yeah, it is exciting. So, yeah, I think this is probably a sort of final wrap-up question is, I know you're keen to encourage young women to consider a career in STEM. If there's a young girl or woman who has spent the weekend on Pokémon Go, what would you say to them to help them see how playing a game connects to STEM subjects and a career that they may not have considered before?
Yeah, no, you're right. I'm really keen to see more women in the industry because it's such fun and women are so good at it. There's a big jump from enjoying a game to wanting to be involved in its development. If girls are out playing games and playing Pokemon Go, that's great. But it's kind of a little bit like saying, you know, if you've watched a really good film, you're suddenly going to want to become a director, or you've had a great meal, so now you want to be a chef. There's a big jump between the two. And I think, for me, those conversations are about creating that desire to be involved, that curious, but how could it be better?
Just sorry to interrupt, but isn't it a jump that boys and young men tend to make more than girls do?
Do completely agree, and I think for boys there's very much more that sense of that curiosity about, you know, here's a thing that I like now, how but I would like it to be like this now, how can I make it like that? And boys have got much more confidence, I think, to in their ability to go and say to go and try and make what they would want. And I think for me with the girls it's about having those conversations, say, okay, you enjoyed that, now what would you like to be the next thing, or how would you like that to be better or different, and you can do that, then get them into those conversations about how they could be involved in that process and making things develop in the ways that they would enjoy and like. There seems to be kind of this inherent sense of the boys that, you know, if I want it to be better, I can go and, you know, I can get involved and make it better. And I think girls have been traditionally less empowered to think like that. For me, it's all about, you know, girls are involved in this. You know, I do programming. I make games. It's something girls can do, and we can make games, and we can make games how we want them to be, and they're fun. And I think it's those conversations. And I think a lot of it's about role models too. We don't have enough good role models for women in games. I mean, you've got some great people. I mean, from coming out of Portsmouth University, she's now in New York, but Mitu Kandeka, who's a great spokeswoman, she's an indie developer, great spokeswoman for women in games, and there are others like her, but not enough yet, I think. And we just need to get more girls involved, and the girls are involved, get them out there so people can see that this isn't a boys dominated area. It's not all about the men, it's about the girls too. And, you know, it's time to take ownership of it. Sorry, Drew.
No. I agree completely.
So I think that was brilliant, Wendy. Thanks ever so much for coming along. And whenever you find some new exciting stuff, we'd love to have you back on to tell us about it.
Oh, we'd love to. There's always new exciting stuff coming out in VR.
And it's so nice to, you know, have someone on the show who actually knows the subject and knows what they're talking about, and isn't just us sort of, you know, rambling about it. Like, I mean, we did our VR episode, and it was just sort of me talking about all the you know, stuff I'd done in my year VR, and it just wasn't very technically minded at all. So it's really nice to have some.
But that user experience is so important as well, though. It's such fun.
Absolutely.
To actually feel like, for somebody who doesn't know VR, to get stuck in and play VR. That's what it's all about in the end.
Yeah.
So get out there and play VR, people. If you're not already sitting under a tree with Pokemon Go. So thanks very much, Dr. Wendy Powell. And until next time, Drew.
Yeah, I think we're all done.
We are. Nice. We have argued the toss.
Cheerio.
If you enjoyed this episode of Argue the Toss, then don't forget to like, subscribe, sign up to our RSS feed. We are on www.gameindustry.com, as well as iTunes. We're on the Game Industry News YouTube channel. So give us a thumbs up, give us some comments. It really makes a huge difference, and thank you so much for listening.